Hello and good evening. I welcome you to today's webinar, The Three Columns of Profitable Trading, exclusively for JFD Brokers. My name is Jens Klatt. I'm the Global Head of Research and Education at JFD Brokers, and I'm very happy to hold this webinar here this week and give you an insight in some of my thoughts, my fundament, let's say, in terms of what I think is necessary to consider when it comes to profitability in trading, and how my mindset, even though this is a very psychological and mental aspect, but somehow it's a set of rules I just follow, and what I firmly believe in here. What profitability in trading is about. Before we start, first of all, very important, let's have a look here at the risk disclaimer. And what I want to start with, in fact, is a small anecdote from my end, and then with something which is, in fact, not from me, but it's something I found on Twitter, was from someone, not sure whether it was quoted there already. After some time I saw a discussion running here between several guys also sharing their thoughts on Twitter and saying that the thoughts quoted here from this guy in terms of the in fact toughest game in the world is not from the guy who quoted it, but in fact was from someone else. So all I want to say is it's not my thoughts you will follow here in terms of what I will present in a few minutes here on the toughest game in the world, even though unfortunately I can't say who is the source of this. But I want to start with something different before. I'm sorry. It's a small story of my a path I followed over the years when it comes to trading. So in fact, it all started somewhere around 2004 when I got interested in the markets, interested in trading in general. That was 3-4 years before the financial crisis hit. That was before high frequency trading took over. Well, we feel it somehow that high frequency trading took over when looking at the crash we've seen here for 2 weeks ago, for example. And so there were several books I read. We had internet back then, I just looked up what could be interesting here and what do you have to read around the markets which could be interesting for you. And sure, I started out with technical analysis, started out with the book from John Murphy on technical analysis, his, let's call it, encyclopedia on this topic. I also read a book on candlesticks from Steve Nissen here, the let's call it godfather of candlesticks, at least in the Western world. And I also read a book series, in fact, which I highly recommend everyone who gets interested in the market. It was the series Market Wizards from Jack Schwager. Let's just do the following. I just have a look here. No, I have no tab open yet. One sec. So this series, Market Wizards from Schwager, that's in fact the book I bought here. Even though you can see it's not just Market Wizards here, this is Market Wizards, this is the new Market Wizards already. Then there's also hedge fund Market Wizards, there's also Stock Market Wizards. I've read at least those four books, not sure, but it seems as if these are all four books here. I have so many books on trading, I don't really remember how many Market Wizards there were, but I refer to these two books here. So Market Wizards and the new Market Wizards. And it's fast. It's an interview series here, in fact, with interviews with top traders. And it's definitely a book everyone should have read here when it comes to trading. Same is true for a book. It's from Edwin Lefebvre. It's Reminiscences of a Stock Operator, for example. The interesting thing about especially those market wizards here, or those two books, but also about the one I just mentioned, Reminiscences of a Stock Operator. This is the biography of Jesse Livermore, one of the greatest speculators of all time. The interesting thing about this is that, in fact, it's not about how to build a trading strategy or what is the holy grail here, which strategy should you definitely trade to be profitable in the markets or so. No, it's more like the view on the markets from traders who made their where. Who made their way up to the top of the trading industry here. So guys which were here mentioned in this book are, for example, Paul Tudor Jones, one of the biggest speculators, traders of all time, hedge fund managers still. And he became a billionaire trading the market. So it's not that every one of us becomes a billionaire trading the markets, but it's more like it's interesting to get an idea of what is this guy driven by? So, what does he look at here? How does he behave in certain situations? How does he recognize or realizes the risk exposure he has in his trading? So, for example, there's also a guy here in this book series. His name is Bruce Kohner, for example. Bruce Kohner is one of the biggest FX speculators of all time. Also, billionaire, retired already, ran a hedge fund, and some very interesting quotes from his end, for example, on where to place the stop. So that's something, if you quote someone, probably makes the most sense to just Google the quote and give it exactly here. Quote, and let's put a stop here behind this too. So let's click on this one. And yeah, for example, the first rule of trading, there are probably many first rules, is don't get caught in a situation in which you can lose a great deal of money for reasons you don't understand. Seems to be obvious to someone. Obviously, this is something when you read it over and over again, you focus automatically here on the great deal of money and your reasons you don't understand. So obviously, there is some connection between risk and money management. And also trading psychology. It's obvious, but you have to really think about this for a while and then draw your own conclusions out of this. Also here, very interesting. Place your stops at a point that, if reached, will reasonably indicate that the trade is wrong, not at the point determined primarily by the maximum dollar amount you're willing to lose. Also here, if you read between the lines, you see, okay, there's not just a connection between risk and money management and trading psychology, but also obviously between market behavior, some kind of trading strategy you follow, and also obviously trading at the mental side of trading, but also the risk and money management here. So there's a strong interaction between those three columns, in fact. And this is happening over and over again in this series of books. So first of all, I mean, it's not that I read through the books and at first glance, as a complete beginner, I came aware of this, but it was more like, okay, you find it out over time. The longer you think about the markets, the behavior, certain patterns repeat, the more often something happens, the deeper you look into it, and you really try to understand what's happening there. And so the interesting thing about this is this, oh, that over the time I came about those three columns of profitable trading I want to share with you, even though I want to start here now with the toughest game in the world. So in fact, so only that you have an idea of where do my thoughts come from. It's not that I just wrote it down and everything's cool. No, it was that I started out reading a book and I read it over and over again. So, in fact, I bought the book somewhere in 2005, somewhere in 2006, probably. That's over 10 years ago. I probably read both books more than 100 times over the time. And some of my former colleagues, for example, were laughing at me. I didn't go to work here by car, but instead by the underground, respectively, by bus. And I mainly do this still today to have the time to read, to have the time to read over and over again. And One day, a former colleague of mine came to me and started laughing at me. And I was wondering why he did that. He said, "Hey, look at this book. I mean, I've seen you several times reading the same book over and over again. Isn't it boring?" And I just found out that, first of all, yes, he's right. Nevertheless, no, it's not getting boring because those books, the Market Wizard series from Schwager, is such a deep pool of knowledge and wisdom around trading, which I personally I'm really thankful for, because this pool and this knowledge is something my beliefs I live by today in the world of trading, respectively, I trade the markets by. These beliefs were formed especially by these books here from Schwager, the Market Wizard series. So now let's come back here to the toughest game in the world first, and then I'll present to you those columns. So it's one information, especially those getting started with trading and listening to me right now. Very important, trading is the toughest game in the world. Many, many people out there underestimate how tough trading is. So trading is, in fact, a game where your opponents are some of the sharpest, smartest, most intelligent, well-informed, most irrational, and also quite often most unethical minds in the world. These are your opponents, okay? So you're playing against, that's by the way also something very interesting, playing against someone. In fact, I consider trading to be kind of a game to some extent. So, for example, during my studies in university, I made ends meet here by playing poker. And the mathematics behind profitability in poker and in trading are not just similar, but in fact they are the same. Even though it's difficult because in poker there's only 52 cards, and then you have a certain probability that one or the other outcome hits. Okay, yes, you have an opponent probably, and he's an irrational guy, let's say, and that's why the outcome probably differs here. But all in all, trading is based on the depth. Based on the width of the market, the outcome is way more unclear what will happen. Even though there is always a formula which comes to you over and over again, and which we will go through here in this webinar too. It's around the so-called expected value. And if you have a, in this case, a clear hit rate over a quite long period of time, you know, if you have a clear loss rate, and you have an average gain and you have an average losing trade, average winning trade, average losing trade. Well, you can calculate an expected value based on the experiences of the past. And if you follow this set of rules over and over again, you can expect to get this amount out of the market then. Even though it takes a lot of time and a lot of effort to get those statistics, and then it's not just sad. Also very interesting. It's not sad that you can capitalize on this expected value and on this advantage, identified advantage. There was a mentee, someone who booked me as a trading coach, and he was sure that the only thing I give to him is a trading strategy. That was especially becoming obvious when we were discussing in one of our sessions around the important topic of trading psychology. And he said, "No, I don't want to hear all this and some mental issues I probably have and all this stuff and risk aversion, respective loss aversion, all that. No, all I need is a strategy. I just follow it and then I will make money." The interesting thing is that at the end, I really tried to convince him that it's not the case. But at the end, I just had to give in. And I told him, okay, yes, well, and let's focus on the strategy, creating the strategy. I obviously can't convince you. And around 1 year later, one evening, I was getting my wife from work, and my mobile rings, and this guy's on the phone, talking to me and saying, "Hey, Jens, I just have a problem." I said, "Okay, what's the problem? Is it bad execution of a trade or something?" "No," he said. "Well, we have the strategy now, but I can't, just can't follow it anymore. I just can't. I don't trust it anymore because there's always this strong feeling when the market is moving against me, which is killing me. and leaving me vulnerable to moving the stop here, taking the stop out of the market, not just only moving it, but taking it out here, avoid a loss here, respectively, trying to catch, not just catch, but trying to take a winning trade quickly. And I said, well, I tried to tell you this 1 year ago. I told you, please study this series here. Please read through several very good books out there, especially from Daniel Kahneman here, Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow. It's on behavioral economics, and the topic of behavioral finance, very important one. In fact, one which we'll cover here in this series in some of the upcoming sessions. And I told him, yes, that's something we call loss aversion. Everyone has this. You have the profitable trading strategy, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you can trade it profitably, since if your mental fundament here, your mental framework and your beliefs are not strong enough to trade it profitably, you will fail to trade it profitably. So this is something very important to mention here. And that's why, no, I made it a little longer than I usually plan to. So that's why I call it playing, because I connect it to games. To me, trading is kind of a game. For others, for example, Marty Schwartz, he was interviewed in the Market Wizard series. Marty Schwartz is a former Navy SEAL. To him, trading is like war. I think it's, and that's something which is getting really interesting, because you have to really know what trading means to you, and you have to find it out yourself, because this makes it way easier for you in the future then to deal with potential mental issues you may face in your trading. But now let's come back here to the topic, the toughest game in the world. So you're playing against computers which are faster than you can blink with an eye, high frequency trading. You are playing against traders who have way more experience than you have. May sound arrogant, but let's put it that way. If you, as the listener to my webinar here right now, you and I, we would step into a ring and say, okay, let's trade the markets. I mean, at the end of the day, you probably get lucky and get out ahead here. But chances that I will take over the long term, probably not even over the long term, but over the midterm, take all your money is way higher because of my experience I have. I faced several very, very important occasions in the market, how to behave. For example, that's also something very interesting around this flash crash. I don't know how many accounts were burned here 2 weeks ago when the Dow Jones crashed that massively. But for example, I was reducing my trading massively. At the end, I know that the basic strategy I follow, for example, performed way better. And I have to find out whether it makes sense to probably just stay with the strategy in terms of volatility rising and rising above a certain threshold. But I can say that I didn't feel comfortable at all to trade the markets based on all the experiences I made over the years, thinning out liquidity. I mean, look at how the market jumped, equities especially, the Dow Jones. It made 400, 500 points within 2, 3, 4 minutes. Liquidity wasn't there anymore. That's how such moves become possible. If liquidity thins out and volatility rises, especially beginners will stand up and say, hey, that's great. Market moves, that's where it can make big money. Well, the problem is, yes, but there's also the environment in which you can lose a big chunk of money. And for me, for example, when it comes to liquidity in the markets, I was an employee with one of the biggest brokers in the world around the S&P crash in 2015 in January. That was when the S&P removed the pack in the Euro-Swiss franc, and Euro-Swiss franc broke below 120. I was working for FXCM back then, and I can tell you, and if you followed the headlines around this event, FXCM nearly got a bust on this one trade, if you want, because they were offering a no debit policy back then, and that cost them something like 300 million. And that was on a Thursday. Friday, we were still counting the losses, let's say. You didn't know when you entered the weekend on this Friday, on the 16th of January, you didn't know whether you will return to the office on Monday or probably Sunday in the evening, you will get a call from, let's say, a CEO or a managing director telling you, okay, guy, well, you don't have a job anymore. We didn't know that. And if you're facing such a situation, and I wasn't a trader there, but somehow I was directly involved based on those developments in the markets, then you definitely know how important it is to have an adequate level of liquidity available all the time. And so this is, for example, also something which comes to my mind right at the moment when I think about experience. And I mean, I'm more than 10 years in this business now. I've seen so many people come and go, but I'm still here. And this is because I respect risk, and I profit from my experiences over the years. It doesn't mean that I don't have losing trades or something like that. Complete opposite is true. I lose money, but at the end, I lose way less than I usually gain, mainly due to the fact that I respect risk in the first place. And that's definitely something where this toughest game in the world comes into play. So then you're playing against funds who have way more money than you have. So while you were thinking probably that sometimes it could make sense to take out a stop here from a losing position, sure, sometimes it could make sense, and probably 9 out of 10 times you come out ahead here in this trade, or permitting in a losing trade here also. Works out 9 out of 10 times. The 10th time you're going bust. That's not necessarily true for funds, but there are also examples in the past where such funds didn't have the adequate funds to stay alive. Let's take as an example long-term capital management in 1998, for example. Lehman Brothers 2008, Bear Stearns 2007 already around the financial crisis, or respectively the real estate sector going broke in the US here. So the thing is that you have to take into account also here, and this is probably even more important, if you have trading or playing against funds who have more money than you have, make sure that you understand that you are not calling the direction of the market, but it's others who tell where the market will go. The only thing you have to do is follow this money inflow, respectively money outflow. Something definitely worth remembering. You're playing against insiders who have way more information than you. Make this short. Remember the film Wall Street from 1987. Gordon Gekko, if you're an inside, you're outside. Sure. Someone who has way more information, also true, by the way, for high frequency trading algorithms here, who are trading faster than you can blink with an eye, for example, are in and out of the market. Well, it's obviously based on insider information sometimes, flash trading in this case, for example. And based on that, I mean, it's obvious that these guys are more likely to be successful with their trading than you are. Something you have to take into account, especially when trading lower time frames. The lower the time frame, the more likely I think it is that you are facing an algorithm here. Let's make things very easy. But an algorithm does not have any kind of emotions or something like that. He's just trading the parameters which he got from the programmer here, and which are obviously profitable. And based on that, you should also take into account that at a certain level, it definitely becomes worth noting that you, with your mouse, respective connection to your broker, it doesn't matter how good your broker might be in terms of order execution, if another algorithm gets served first because he has a faster way or faster connection here to the stock exchange, for example, or in general to the market. Then this could definitely trigger some pain at your end in terms of losing money or in terms of diminishing profitability here. Now, next question, very important around JFD brokers. What's so important and what's so interesting around JFD brokers as a broker? You're playing probably against your broker. Not every broker, again, is as cool, fair, and transparent as JFD is, meaning that the majority, for example, has a market making license and is allowed to trade against you. JFD has not. JFD is a 100% DMA STP broker. But just imagine every trade you enter, it's not just that you have to try to capitalize on an identified edge here, but on top of that, you have to make sure that you're also outplaying your broker. Yeah, the partner. Usually it should be your partner. In most of the cases, it's not. That's definitely something which is making trading one of the toughest periods in the world. And then there is, already mentioned several times, your inner voice which tries to manipulate you. So the thing is, do you have a game plan? Or respectively, do you know on which columns profitable trading is built on? If not, well, only thing one can say is good luck then. Because all winning trades will be lucky punches, while the losing trades will be, let's say it will be the rule instead of a coincidence, let's say here. And so here, the thing now comes that obviously it's important to build such a game plan, but to build such a game plan, I think it's necessary and very important to know on which columns profitable trading is built on. And so here's the first column, obviously risk and money management. In fact, I didn't invent this myself, but I found it out myself. And the good thing about finding out something yourself is that this means that you had to study something in depth here, which is giving you a very intense feeling when, for example, looking at such a column as risk and money management. To some of you, it might probably only be look at it and say, yeah, that means risk only 1% per trade, but nothing is further from the truth. It's way more than that. Know in depth what is expected value, what's the payoff ratio, so the ratio between the average gain, the average losing trade, what's the risk of ruin, how to run simulations to get to know your risk of ruin, also how to run a simulation based on all those risk parameters to get an idea of what can you expect here. This is also something where when you know what to expect and how several simulated capital curves could be arranged on a chart, it's also something which is very important in terms of trading psychology, because your expectation probably comes down. So usually it's that trading beginners are very let's say, well, I have 10,000 euros here, I'll be a millionaire within 6 months. So that's like, I want to hit the home run here and get rich as quick as possible. In this context, remember, try to imagine, not to remember, probably try to imagine what happened around Bitcoin. Everyone was talking about Bitcoin. Do you know how many millionaires we had overnight by all these moves here? The question now is, after the market collapsed nearly 60, 70%, now coming back above 10,000, yes, okay, but nevertheless, can you imagine how many people out there got burned, were millionaires, and then lost probably everything because they bought bitcoins on leverage here with their credit card and that stuff? So the thing about this, why I mentioned this, is expectation in trading is something very, very important. And if you really know what to expect, you can cope with losses and the fear of losing way, way better than anyone else out there. In fact, everything around trading psychology somehow comes down to the topic of fear, but we don't want to go into too much details here. And then on top of that, there's also, a strategy with an advantage, obviously. So you have to observe the market to understand certain market structures, to observe and probably identify certain patterns which happen over and over again, and then find out, probably via programming, this pattern here, trying to figure out whether this pattern you just identified can be capitalized here with an adequate risk and money management plan, and then also based on a mental stable mental framework that it can really be capitalized here, and that you can make money trading this pattern over and over again here. So these are my three columns, or in general, I'd say, the three columns which profitable trading is built on. And when you know these three columns, you obviously have to make sure that you understand all of them, again, in depth, and understand that they are connected and with each other. And this means if one column is missing, it's obvious that the whole product of profitability in trading won't play out as expected. So let's say if a trader fails to succeed in one area or doesn't master it in detail, the chances of being profitable in trading are close to zero. What do I mean by that? Well, let's just play with those columns here: risk and money management and trading psychology. It's quite obvious. So working, respectively trading, with an adequate position size has consequences on the mental stability of the trader, which makes perfect sense, since a position size which is far too big will lead to behavior of fast profit taking and letting losing trades run. Let's put this, let's get here into this topic with a more detailed example everyone will understand. Let's assume you have a job and it's a 9-to-5 job, and you're making, let's say, 3,000 euros net per month. Okay, so now you have 3,000 euros per month, and somewhere an uncle says, "Hey guy, you know what? You're nice. Here, take 500,000 euros. It's just to build your future, build a company, buy a house, whatever. Here's 500,000 euros for whatever reason." And you decide, "Well, you know what? I want to be a day trader. Day trading is cool." And then you say, "Well, I read a book on trading and it said, do not risk more than 1% of your overall trading capital. Don't do that." Well, it's cool. 500,000, 1% is 5,000 euros per trade. Cool. Next thing is you decide to trade, let's say, a strategy we call open range breakout. Let's say we do this in the DAX, and let's say this strategy is traded within a range here. I usually take a range between 8 to 9:05 a.m. German time. This is 7 to 8:05 a.m. GMT. And then we say, okay, we take the high and the low here. Once the market breaks out on the upside, we are going long, placing the stop below the low of the range and the other way around. So you're risking 5,000 euros here. Let's say, let's just assume the range is 50 points. So that means if you're saying I'm risking 5,000 euros, you're buying obviously 100 contracts once the breakout on the upside occurs. The risk is 50 points. You multiply those 50 points with 100 contracts, which means 100 euros per point, which means 50 multiplied with 100 is 5,000, 1% of 500,000. So that's very nice. Now the market breaks out on the upside. And what does it do? Well, let's have a look at the DAX today. Perfect. Perfect. Let's just assume this is our range and this is what we do here. So this is the open range, in fact. So no big coincidence that I made this a topic here. And now let's have a look here at this. So this is the open range. Those purple lines, the market breaks out. Obviously, it breaks out. Great. Obviously, the market did not continue here, but in fact, it just broke lower from here. So now imagine you're trading with 1,000 with 5,000 euro risk here, and seeing the market break out. Well, this is great. Probably you don't even face the problem I'm now presenting to you here, since you might say, "Hey, well, I take the profit here since the market broke out for something like 15, 20 points, and I just made within 30 minutes. I made 30 in within 30 minutes. I made 2 grand." This is 2/3 of what I usually make 1 month working 9-to-5, probably in a job I don't even like. Okay, so probably you just cash in the chips here. Probably you didn't cash in the chips and see the market moving against you, and now you're behind. You just lost one month salary here when the market just broke into the range. You weren't stopped out, so the range here can be found here. This is usually where your stop is placed. So you see the market moving against you. You're now seeing that you're probably losing within, in this case here, within 1.5 to 2 hours, you will probably lose around 2 monthly salaries. Don't you think that this will definitely affect you somehow? It will. Sure, it will. So what will you most likely do? You probably take out the stop. If it's not a fully automated strategy and it's a discretionary trading approach, or you're trading this strategy even though it could be automated, you trade this here from a discretionary standpoint, I definitely guarantee you that you will most likely take out the stop here and see the market collapsing. If the pain is big enough, you'll probably take out the trade, and then rather soon later, probably that will somewhere here, You will have lost something like, well, if you enter the market here, that's 100 points. 100 points with 100, that's 10 grand. So you just burn away 2% of your overall trading equity, which is 500,000. Remember that? And then seeing the market turning around. Somewhere here, probably you now start to think, probably I buy again. But don't let's we don't want to overcomplicate things here. Why I mention all this is that obviously, if the position size does not fit your style, your current living situation, you will definitely face a problem here in your trading, and you will definitely it will definitely result in a behavior which in the long run will result in you busting your account, because what you will naturally do is leaving losing trades open for too long and losers growing too big in comparison to winning trades, which are probably too small, because you just cash in the chips and they say, hey, I can re-enter the market later on. I just made 1 grand. And it's nearly, if I do this 3 times, I just have 1 month in salaries, 1 month in salary. So to give you an idea of, probably some of you might listen to this right now and just think, oh, is this really true? Yes, it is. It is. I've experienced things as some of you won't believe me. So what I'm talking about is, for example, there was someone who opened an account with a broker, and I was asked whether I could call her, I don't even remember, and whether I could give him a private coaching here to give him some ideas. So very big account, and I said, okay, yeah, well, sure, no problem. Could you please hand over the account statement, then a detailed account statement, so that I have an idea which markets are traded here and which strategy and so on. Answer was no, sorry, we can't. And I said, okay, what's the problem? I mean, I told them I really need this because it's information and I want to work with this. Unfortunately, it's too much. We just can't send you the document via email and we can't print it too. I said, why? Because the trading frequency is that high that the document exceeds something like, I don't know, one gigabyte or something like that. And it's 1 month of trading. So just that you have an idea of how high the trading frequency of some people is out there. Discretionary, purely discretionary. So we're not talking about automated trading strategies or something like that. And so this is not very far from the truth, which shows perfectly that this mental instability, let's call it, is one of the main reasons people are unprofitable. Because what you can definitely assume is that winning trades where grabbed very fast while losing trades weren't close here. That's in fact also true for this example I just mentioned. So the floating losses were enormous when those losses were back then were realized, the account would have been gone. So loss of something like 80 to 85%. So let's come to the next point. So next two columns interacting strongly with each other, trading psychology and trading an advantageous trading strategy. Changing the strategy over and over again, especially after seeing a series of losing trades, for example. Possible reason, the trader does not trust its strategy since he doesn't really know whether his approach is profitable in the long run, or he does not know how long losing trades, for example, on average take. Very, very normal, in fact. So that's one of the reasons why an approach where someone comes and says, hey, be my trading coach, and you say, yeah, sure, you agree on everything, and then he comes and says, okay, all I want is a profitable trading strategy, and you say, yeah, sure, I could give you, I just can't give you one, but you could have 10, no problem, I could just send you 10 profitable trading strategies. Well, the thing is, you won't make any money out of this. The reason, well, you don't know what is the trading logic behind this. You don't know if you can really trust those strategies, especially if you don't know what profitable trading is built on. You can't even calculate an expected value. So how we want to trade a strategy which is obviously profitable if you don't even know what profitability means. This is definitely something which is also perfectly shown in an example which many of us probably know. Probably I've heard about the turtle traders. Turtle Traders, that was an experiment which was run by Richard Dennis, and the other guy was Richard Dennis, and no, I forgot his name. Richard Dennis? Oh gosh, I forgot. One second. I have to Google him. He was also, William Eckert. I'm sorry. So I don't even need to Google that. Bill Eckert. William Eckert and Richard Dennis. They ran an experiment here. They were seeing someone feeding turtles in Singapore or something like that. And then they asked the question, do you think it's possible to grow a profitable trader? And that what they did was, in fact, they came out with the idea to hire a basket of traders, and at the end they gave him one strategy. It was a very simple approach which you can download easily on the internet today. It's the so-called donkey and channel, which is in fact, in its basic version, saying buy the break to the high of the last 20 days and respectively sell the break to the lowest low of the last 20 days here and place your stop accordingly. So depending on what, probably you just place the stop here below the low then of this indicator. Just have an idea here. Let's just look at this. Let's have a look here at the daily chart and the DAX. And then, so in this case, it's not called Donkian, but it's called the high low. It's HHLL. So that is the way it looks like. So, and what you can see, it's this is the 10 in this case. So, which means if the market now would break, for example, here 11,900 points, this purple line on the downside, then you're selling the market and you're placing the stop here above the high of this channel. This is the strategy. Trend following markets during the 70s, 80s. It was a highly profitable trading approach, and in fact, even though it's easily duplicable, the strategy, we don't go into too much detail here. Even though it's easily duplicable, most of the traders failed, and that was mainly due to trading psychology and not having a stable mental framework your trading is built on, because they didn't trust the strategy. They overruled the system, and overruling the system means that they are intervening at spots where they say, hey, the market moved already that much, let's say on the upside. It can't go any further. And then you say, okay, I take out the trade. That probably makes sense. Sometimes it makes sense. And I want to say that I do the same. I have profitable basic strategies, which I try to optimize by intervening from a discretionary standpoint. But you have to count whether your intervention here really makes sense or not, and really wonder, why did I intervene? You have to really, in very detailed, write down, why did you intervene? How did I feel when I did this? And all this. It's a very intensive approach. And if you find out that this does not work out, the system performs better because because of your mental instability, or your experience not being given to such an extent which would be needed, that you can intervene here. Well, then just let the system alone and let it trade the parameters and do not intervene at all, even though many just can't do this. It's also something, obviously, which comes down to trust in the system itself. Fear of missing out, fear of losing again if you hit, let's say, five, six, seven losing trades in a row. No one can really trust the system which is doing that. Last year, for example, I started a small experiment here that was in an FX Street webinar. And there we had an open range breakout set up in the S&P. It was live trading event around the US market opening. I ran this pro, or I still run this webinar here. And the first four occasions I made a setup topic, all four were losers. Well, after 6 months, around Christmas, I said, well, let's sit together, let's have a look whether the strategy performed well. I bet none of the guys which initially listened to me after the third loss, probably after the fourth one, have followed me since then and seen that the strategy itself would have been or would turn out a profitable result here around Christmas. So it does not mean that now, from now on, the strategy will keep on performing well, but it perfectly shows that here, obviously, trust is a very important component. Even though that means trust in my person here and my skill level, even though it's the same when it comes to a trading strategy, a profitable trading strategy. Okay, let's have a look at the third component here, risk money management and trading and advantageous trading strategy. Also very interesting. The question is, how big is your advantage in your trading strategy? And if you know your advantage, if you know your edge, well, then you can calculate based on a deep and detailed knowledge around risk and money management. You can try to find out what's the optimal position size. So that's, for example, something which is always very important. If someone sends me an email and says, "Hey, what's the right position size?" I'll tell him, "Well, it depends. Sometimes it could make sense to trade 2% of your trading equity. Sometimes it makes sense 0.5%. Sometimes 0.1%. It depends. You just can't tell based on the question alone, which what's the right position size in your trading." You just can't tell an adequate and a concrete a right answer here. But it depends. It depends. And that's also something where I say, well, trading book just saying only risk 1% of your trading capital per trade. Well, this is not true. It's far away from truth, in fact, because it could be that 1% is too much because your advantage does not justify that if you're only willing to, let's say, accepting a drawdown of 25% or so. So it could be that 1% is definitely too much. It could be that your edge is tremendously great because you're very experienced, you're a really great trader. It could be that you have no trouble risking 3%. Well, in theory, at least, because the thing is, you're probably very, very experienced, you have a deep knowledge about the markets, but you're not mentally stable enough to risk 3% per trade. Even though you know that this would result in the optimal growth of your equity curve, this is also something which comes down here to the so-called Kelly criterion, something we will discuss in one of the further webinars here. But that's something where I say, well, it's obviously a play together of these three columns here: trading psychology, advantageous trading strategy, and risk and money management. So now I want to hurry up a little. Unfortunately, way too much, even though this formula is something you have to take with you. If you take anything out of this webinar, take this formula with you, because this formula is something really, 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 really important. Probably the most important formula in trading in general. Because some of you might wonder, and also something which I somehow mentioned already here, market wizards, this series. If you're reading through these books, you can, and not just these books, but every trading book out there, you will find out that every great trader somehow refers to let winning trades run, cut losing trades short. That's a great input. But the question is why? And if you have the why, well, then sometimes it's way easier to find out a how. And the great thing about this is, look at this formula here. Letting winning trades run means making the average winning trade big, right? And cutting losing trades short means making the average losing trade small. So if you make this one big, multiplied with the hit rate, which you can probably stabilize, let's say, at a certain level, this term here increases, while this obviously decreases, which means your overall expected value grows. It gets bigger. If it gets bigger, it's bigger zero especially, that means you're making money with your trading. That's why you should let running trades, winning trades run, and why you should cut losing trades short. That's it. But now the thing is, if no one tells you that there is a strong correlation between those two, well, you probably will never find out this, but just read over these lines and just say, "Hey, great, yes, awesome. Make winning trades big. Cut losing trade short, that's it. Okay, great." You read over this over and over again, but no one really knows why. Well, thanks to this formula around the expected value, you can now obviously focus on what's really important. For example, if you have a trading strategy which is showing an expected value of, let's say, 10 cents per euro you risk, that means if you're risking 1,000 euros per trade, you multiply this with 10 cents, you make on average, if it's a winning or losing trade, you make on average 100 euros per trade. from a mental perspective, this is very, very important, because it's less likely that you will fear losing trades anymore. Even more important, let's say you have a basic strategy where you exactly know the hit rate, where you exactly know the loss rate, where you exactly know the average winning trade and the average losing trade. Let's say over a time frame of something like 15 years or so, you made a back test, you run the back test here, and you just find out, well, it works. This strategy works here in over the last 15 years. It's generating a positive expected value. Okay, cool. So now I was talking about intervening sometimes into trades. What do I aim on when I intervene in a trade? Well, my first target here is obviously to try to increase the expected value. That's what I aim on. That's the only thing I aim on. When I intervene in a trading strategy which has already a positive expected value, I try to increase this expected value. That way, it could happen. And there were occasions in the past when I was saying, hey, I had a good trading day yesterday. Someone asked me, hey, what does this mean? Did you make big money? No, I didn't. I lost yesterday. Everyone's looking at you and saying, what do you mean you lost money? How can trading day be good if you lost money? Well, usually on average, I lose 500 euros. But yesterday, I was capable, thanks to my trading skills, to reduce the average losing trade here, or the losing trade itself, to 250 euros. That means that the average losing trade is reduced. That means that here this term gets smaller and the overall expected value increases. If you try, or if you start to look at your trading that way, you will find out that trading obviously is something completely different than calling the direction of the market, but it's to optimize and increase the expected value. This is how professional traders increase their profitability, by looking at this formula here. And that's, if you really, somehow I feel, it's a little weird, I think. I mean, it's only a formula. It's not that boom, but I'm really passionate about this, because over the years, I became passionate about this, because it's something so important to understand when it comes to trading, this formula. And I just don't understand why not many, many more educators, trading coaches, also traders giving presentations, seminars here, come down to this formula and really try to go into detail here with this formula. That's why I highly recommend you to just snapshot this formula and really try to get the message behind this. So, oh, by the way, a question here from a participant: if the webinar is recorded, yes, it is. And on top of that, I will upload it here on YouTube, on the YouTube channel from JFD Brokers. One second, I just guide you through this. So YouTube, and then you have here JFD Brokers, usually that should get the job done. Yes, here, just subscribe to this YouTube channel.
Change.
And so I post it in the chat box, and then you will find it here in the playlist, and usually it should be available under Power Webinars. That's usually where we upload it. We have to rearrange this. That's not very optimal here, but usually it should be here under Power Webinars. Probably I also do it here under Events, but most likely it will be under Power Webinars. So also understanding that with decreasing payoff ratio, for example, shedding a chance of hitting the risk of ruin increase exponentially. So that's, for example, two charts which are probably very interesting for you here: risk of ruin, payoff ratio. So the higher the payoff ratio, this is the ratio between the average gain and the average losing trade here. Obviously, the higher this grows here, the less of the chance that you reach the risk of ruin. So meaning crushing your account, even though you won't really get this to zero. So there is one out of a trillion times that you probably reach the point of ruin here. But nevertheless, the higher your hit rate and the bigger the payoff ratio, usually the lesser the chance that you will hit your payoff ratio here. That's also some parameters you can then play with here in so-called Monte Carlo simulations, for example. This is a little too much now. So many more things to talk about here, in fact. But just take this chart here with you, And your target should be to increase your payoff ratio, get the average gain compared to the average losing trade bigger, and on the other hand, try to increase the hit rate. And always remember this formula around the expected value, and you will find out why you should do this. Average gain grows, average losing trade decreases, hit rate this direction, losing rate will obviously decrease, and obviously the expected value grows. Expected value growing means more profitable or higher profitability in your trading. So then also here, the trading psychology, I'll just flip to this. Let's focus on this one here. It's a very interesting thing to understand trading psychology, because some people out there, they say emotions in trading are something you have to get rid of. It's not true, because emotions are essential also in your trading. There are positive and there are negative emotions. Yes, this is true. Nevertheless, emotions are essential. And it all comes down here to the so-called zone, which is the highest point on the so-called Jerks-Dodson curve. It's here, performance and the arousal. And obviously, this is like, you can easily understand this. For example, when you look at a soccer game, obviously, even though there might be, let's say, Cristiano Ronaldo, he has to have a warm-up, and he has a warm-up routine, and this is worked out, and they really worked in depth on how to get to this point here, to this highest point on the Jerks-Dodson curve, to reach this highest point in terms of your arousal, to be capable of perform enormously and outstandingly well. This is the same, and this is exactly true for trading. So if Cristiano Ronaldo, as the best soccer player around the world, has to warm up, obviously you have to warm up yourself. I mean, sure, if you're running a purely automated trading approach, sure, things are getting a little easier, you might say, because you might say, well, I just click the button and then that's it. But on the other hand, even if you're running a purely quantitative trading approach, reaching this highest point on the Jerks-Dodson curve, should be achieved, especially when working out or finding out what worked well, what didn't work well, how to interpret the parameters. So like, yeah, if you want, you're kind of a professor trying to find out something new and how to bring your trading, even though it's pure, most of the time probably purely quantitative, how to bring it to a new level here. And how to combine those parameters optimally with each other so that you get an even better and increasing positive expected value. So that's it when it comes to trading psychology. And then we have also, sure, the advantageous trading strategy. I think this is probably the most important thing I want to end this webinar then with here. So the strategy we are trading, it should fit our personality, respectively the character of the trader, which also means it has to fit the life circumstances of you, of him or her, which means someone, for example, who's working full-time, 50 hours a week, will very unlikely be able to trade an approach profitably which generates 50 trades a day. That's in fact hardcore scalping. Thing is, it's not really true, because I'm talking obviously about the discretionary trading approach. I mean, you could easily run an expert advisor here, which generates that many trades a day and still be profitable in your trading. But I think you get the point. So just assume that you're probably not the quantitative guy. You're not running an expert advisor here because you don't trust robots, let's say. And that's why you have to trade discretionary. Very important information. You should write this down and really try to build your trading accordingly, because this will then reduce chances that you are out of your optimal out of your zone, in case of the Jerks-Dodson, out of your zone here when it comes to trading, because obviously if you don't trust robots, you will have difficulties to trade with them. The other way is true if you have troubles to get rid of your emotions. Probably discretionary trading is not the right thing for you, and you should focus on robots. If you don't trust robots, well, probably then your target should be get rid of those negative emotions, or try to trust those robots and build a belief which makes it possible for you to then that you can automate your trading and your strategies. Yeah, so we could easily extend this to another hour or so, and it was a pleasure. In fact, it was a pleasure. I just hope that you feel as passionate about this topic here, trading in general, but also these columns in terms of trading as I do. And I really look forward to the next event taking place next week on Tuesday, again at 4:30 p.m. GMT German time, so 3:30 p.m. GMT. I wish you happy trading. Watch your stops. Have a nice evening. If you have any questions, oh, unfortunately, I haven't written down my email address here. One second. Let me just see. Is it somewhere here? No. Okay, let me just change this. One second. I will just change it here. Okay, so it's okay, so that's my mail address. If you have any questions, please just let me know, shoot them over. I'd really like to answer them, and so that's it from my end. Have a nice evening, enjoy yourself, take care, and to talk to you again then next week on Tuesday. I look forward to it. Yeah, see you, take care, and bye-bye.